In this video, we are going to do some myth busting for scapular dyskinesis.
Enroll in our online course now. Link is in the video description.
Hi and welcome back to Physio Tutors. Scapular dyskinesis is an alteration or deviation in a normal resting or active position of the scapula during shoulder movement. Sometimes scapular dyskinesis is also referred to as SIG scapula, which is an acronym for scapular malpositioning, inferior medial border prominence, coracoid pain and malpositioning, and dyskinesis of scapular movement. According to Kirby et al. In the year 2007, 77% of physiotherapists believe that a scapular humeral ratio of 1 to 2 is normal. However, the 1 to 2 ratio was first described in 1944 in a single subject by Inman et al. And it got stuck. In reality, research shows that ratios vary considerably depending on gender, age, hand dominance, the plane of movement, bilateral or unilateral arm movement, speed of movement, different loads, different sports the patient is playing, fatigue and pain. So in fact, we can't really say what normal means. If we look at epidemiological data, Byrne et al. In the year 2016 describe a prevalence of scapular dyskinesis in non-overhead athletes with 33% and even more in overhead athletes with 61%. So in a lot of cases, scapular dyskinesis might be a functional adaptation rather than a contributing factor to shoulder pathology. But are we able to identify patients with scapular dyskinesis in the first place? On our channel, there are different methods for clinicians to assess scapular dyskinesis, like the Kipler-4 type classification, the yes-no method, or the scapular dyskinesis test. What they all have in common is that their inter-rater reliability is only moderate. This means there will be quite a couple of patients where two examiners won't agree on if scapular dyskinesis is present or not. The most important question is, can scapular dyskinesis lead to shoulder pain? So, is it a problem? Up until today, 5 different cohort studies have been conducted examining this very question. Only 2 of those studies show that scapular dyskinesis is indeed a factor for the development of shoulder pain. What is eye-catching about those 5 studies is that the 2 positive studies were conducted in elite level athletes, one in an elite handball population, the other in an elite rugby population, while the remaining 3 studies were conducted in sub-elite level athletes. So, even if we still assume that scapular dyskinesis might play a role in the development of shoulder pain, this leads us to the next question. Can we correct it? Should we focus on motor control training to improve scapular motion? McQuaid et al. In the year 2016 wrote a critical and theoretical perspective on scapular stabilization and summarizes the following. Although some studies suggest that scapular stabilization exercises influence scapular thoracic muscle activation, it is not known whether increases in scapular thoracic muscle activation or changes in activation ratios translate to any lasting kinematic pattern improvements. In total, there is little evidence to suggest that scapular motor control training can functionally affect scapular muscle activation. Learning to consciously control scapular position and using visual biofeedback appear to be good methods for immediately altering scapular thoracic muscle activation or motion. Yet, the long-term clinical significance and transferability to daily functional tasks remains unknown. To sum it up, scapular dyskinesis might be a functional adaptation rather than a movement fault, and it's really hard to tell what is normal or not. Unless you are treating elite level athletes, it's probably not that important, and we can also not correct its motion. Therefore, focus on making your patient stronger without these awkward scapular control exercises that are somewhat unnatural and hard to perform for the patient. Oh, and one more thing.
But there is one more thing.
A lot of research suggests to focus on strengthening of the middle and lower trapezius muscles instead of the upper trapezius based on EMG studies. Click on the video right next to me in order to learn why this is probably not a good idea. All right, this concludes our video on myth busting for scapular dyskinesis. Let us know if you like these sort of videos in the comments down below and if you want more of that. You can expect stuff like that in our online course as well, which you can find on study.physiotutors.com. I will see you in the next video. Take care, bye.